We'd like to thank all of you for coming out today for this dining. It's basically a demonstration of peace to basically collaborate with so many other medical students with the Physicians National Health Program to raise awareness of the Michael Brown case in Ferguson, as well as police brutality that's affecting African Americans nationwide. And basically, the purpose of this is to raise awareness of how it's our duty as future physicians to be more aware of what's going on with our patient population and how to more effectively tackle that matter.
So you can keep me inside the pockets of your ripped jeans, holding me closer till our eyes meet. You won't ever be alone. Wait for me to come home.
The advertised plight of my black community doesn't always reflect every one of us. And yes, I mean advertised, because it seems that we have all since become a phenomenon that can't be explained. Visualized and videotaped to be exploited on national television. I've read far too many Facebook posts and Instagram memes wondering where black lives have gone. Walked away, ran away, got pushed away, didn't have money and couldn't decide. But they never speak of those things which we know are true. It has been far too long since someone spoke of the black lives that have died, the black men who fought unyieldingly yet still couldn't fight enough. And no, I can't speak for the entire nation, but I can speak for those like me. Those who hurt but can't cry about it. Those who bleed but can't see the wound, and those who seek refuge and are continuously told to be a man. So this is for black people, white people, Latino people, deaf people, blind people, just people who, unlike mainstream media portrays, lost their hearts to something unforeseen, something inevitable. You see, when this happens early in your life, you are subject to at least once a year, maybe more, that you are entitled to become a child again, wanting your hearts back like never before. Wanting so desperately to hear the beating of that everlasting drum that sits within your soul. We are hurting. And I am stuck between hating the law and mourning for my future, but it should have never been this way. Because my father was a little bit shorter than me. He was black, near my skin complexion, masculine, and a figure of safety. I want so badly to ask his counterparts why they look at us like we are nothing. Why was I pulled over at gunpoint by three police cars for making a U-turn? And why doesn't our nation mourn the life of the killer as well? Yes, we have every right to mourn the death of these young Americans, but for once I want a solution. I want to sit down and talk with the killers and seek justice through their prayers for forgiveness. So tonight, I'm gonna sleep with the things that remind me of my daddy. The badge of honor he wore on duty will comfort me like swaddling clothes. His uniform shirt unstained with blood but saturated with his courage, and I'm vowing to never let go until morning. Tonight, I'm taking the time to cry like a child. Head hung low in the shadows of my bedroom, my tears fall quicker than the snow outside my window, piling up into 3 feet of rivers flowing through my bedroom. I'm gonna build a boat out of my sorrows and float with the current. No paddle, because you can't seem to really control your life anymore at this point, and there's no use in false hopes. So tonight, I'm taking the time to be human again. To get out of this just push through state, to get out of this America hates me state and begin to find a solution and just sit and think and sit and cry and sit and scream and sit then walk then sit then fall then cry then bawl then write then stop, but only when morning comes. Because morning seems to bring about a cleansing light, but it's dark now. And there is a stench that lingers within the hallways of our minds, and it reminds me of freedom for some reason. In August of 2005, there were people gutting their houses in New Orleans from a storm like no other. If you were to smell the streets, you would smell all things being washed away, and you would behold that all things were being made new. Because sometimes it takes a storm to begin this process. So in the 4.5 minutes that we've laid here, we will get up, get dressed, and start to make a change in the life of others. Because Daddy, I'm sure you didn't die when I was three for me to cry about it for the rest of my life. I'm sure you and all other police officers have done it for freedom.
And I will keep you inside the pocket of my ripped jeans, holding you closer till our eyes meet, and I won't ever be alone. Just wait for me to come home.
Well, on behalf of University of Rochester and all of the affinity groups, we would like to thank you for coming out and supporting this peaceful demonstration.
So we were holding a die-in in support of 70 other medical schools in the United States who are joining in on the fight against police brutality in America that's disproportionately affecting communities of color. And so as rising physicians, it's important for us to start a conversation about this as our patients will be experiencing these stressors. And as we've seen, that these sorts of police brutality incidences take lives, they cause stress, they interfere with the lives and well-being of our patients and our friends, our family, and just people in our community. And so we wanted to join in support of them and also to start lay a foundation for future discussions on the issue. The Student National Medical Association is planning on holding a discussion on physician bias, working on identifying, making it okay to know that you have a bias and coming up with more effective ways of dealing with biases other than knowing you have a bias than what you do. And how do you prevent that from alienating your patients, your peers, and just understanding how people experience life differently and how we can go about creating effective change. I just think that it's important to discuss issues of race and how they disproportionately affect, how it's a system that's disproportionately affecting people of color. And not to lay blame on any person, I think both minorities and people who are not of color need to go through a period of just healing from these events, but also events of our past. And not talking about the issue isn't going to help us move forward. And so this is all about moving towards change and towards equality for everyone in the United States. And just particularly at the medical school, figuring out what our role as future physicians will be in trying to aid in that change.
Well, my father died in the line of duty as a police officer down in Louisiana when I was 3 years old in 1995. It was actually Christmas Day, not to make it more sad, but it was on Christmas Day. And so recently, you know, coming to medical school and starting this new area of my life, it's been really hard because my dad's not here. You know, everyone wants to call the dad and like be excited. Oh, I saw my first patient, or, you know, I passed my first exam or something like that, you know, and I wasn't able to have those moments. So earlier in the semester, maybe about a month ago, I wrote this piece, which is titled 12/25/95, which is the day he passed away in a car accident. He was off topic. He was driving to a fight or something. It was a fight that was going on in Lake Charles or some sort of altercation. I was three, so I don't know all the details. And on the way there, he lost control of his car, his police car. And instead of driving into the Lake Charles, he drove the other way and struck a tree. And he was killed instantly on impact. And so, for me, writing is very therapeutic. You know, I always tell my friends, like, you know, you should write. If you're ever feeling like you're just overwhelmed or you just need to get things out and you don't want to complain to everybody, just write. And so a couple weeks ago, I wrote this piece because I was really, like, you know, down in the dumps and I just needed to get it all out of me. So I wrote this piece. And then ironically, about a week after I wrote it, the grand jury announcements were made about not indicting Officer Wilson in Ferguson. And so I tweaked it a little bit to go, you know, more along with the things that have happened to me by police officers, like being pulled over at gunpoint for no apparent reason at all by three police cars, which is very scary. And my dad being a police officer. So I sort of see both parallels. Like I really trust police officers because that's what my dad was. And I'm also afraid of police officers in a sense because of the things that have been going on and because I'm a young black male. And so I put those two things together into one piece and I got what I got today.
Yeah, no, it's really beautiful.
Thank you. In my piece, I mentioned earlier that it's not always, it is about the person who was killed. It is about the young Americans who are being killed senselessly, but it's also about the killer. We've never taken the moment to sit down and, you know, like talk with these people or just sit down and pray for them and, you know, because they're going through a lot as well. And I'm not taking up with anyone at all. It's just that we have to remember that everyone is human. So the same way that the family of the killed is hurting is the same way that the family of of the killer is hurting, because they probably never thought that their son was going to go to work one day as a police officer and kill, you know, a young black American, and then this be national, and people are protesting about it. So everyone's hurting just the same. We have to remember to keep everyone, you know, in prayer and remember to think about them. Especially when we're protesting, because I've seen a lot of protesters like yelling in police officers' faces, like, "I hate you, you're scumbags." Those police officers aren't the ones that killed them. You know, it was one person that made a mistake, or that maybe it was malicious, but it was one person. It's not the entire police system. So we have to continue to keep our trust in the people who are protecting us.
Yeah. Okay, on Facebook yesterday, I saw someone at a different school post about this med student diet, and I clicked on the link to see what they said, over 50 schools, and Rochester wasn't on the list, which was surprising to me, because we are, I feel like as a school, our culture is very committed to social justice, the administration is very committed to social justice, so I was just really surprised. So I emailed Dr. Adrian Morgan and Ayala and said, you know, what are we doing for this? And everyone said, oh, what is it, tomorrow? And then it just sort of happened. We started posting about it on social media, and I think there was such a huge need for it. Students felt such a need for it that it came together really easily. It was a few posts on social media, a couple of emails, and then the passion of the students.
Yeah.
As everyone knows, Rochester is really big on the biopsychosocial model, and so instilling that within the students, you know, we're taught to look more into people's lives and to look, you know, you're not just a patient with a disease, you're a patient who has psychological needs. When you find out, you know, that you have a terminal disease, or even if it's just a cold and you're coming into the office, you know, we're more concerned about the social side of it. You know, how are you going to be affected by it? How is your family going to be affected by it? Your cycle, you know, and your psyche. How do you perceive your disease? How do you perceive coming into the doctor's office? Whether it's something, you know, minimal or something, you know, really detrimental to your life. And so in doing movements like this, it definitely feeds into that, in teaching that, you know, it's not just about the patient that's walking in, and it's not just about what they look like or who they are or where they've come from. It's more about, you know, what type of person they are. It's more about their family that you're worried about. It's about their, you know, their finances that you're worried about. All of these things that feed into the biopsychosocial model. And I truly appreciate that as a student here, that we're taught these things. It's not just, you know, oh, this patient comes in with a cold and you deal with them. No, you're taught, you know, they come in, they're coming into your office for a reason. They've chosen you as a doctor, so you need to treat them as a human being and treat them as someone that you are, you know, you would potentially want to be treated as if you were going into the doctor.
Yeah, continue to remind students to keep it in the forefront of everyone's, you know, awareness, and we're aware that this is an issue.
Absolutely.
The problem with systemic racism, I think, especially in healthcare providers, is that no one individually is necessarily a racist.
Right.
You know, it's not that they're not a bad person. It's not a bad person who's a racist. It's,
right.
We have these ideas that you just kind of inherit, you have these stereotypes that they. Good people think they must not have because they're good people. Mm-hmm. And that's not, the evidence shows pretty strongly that that's not the case at all,
right.
That there are profound racial disparities mm-hmm. in healthcare in the United States.
Absolutely.
And it costs lives. And if we as healthcare professionals care about lives, this needs to be, we need to be aware of this all the time. This has to change. We can do better.
Right.
We must do better.
Right, right. And I think for us, it's more about, you know, not necessarily going to protest and, you know, chant outside and walk around the school with signs, which is great for those who are able to do that and who are doing that. For us, it's more of internally taking this to make a change, you know. So if we're all trained as better people and as more humanistic people, then we're able to go out into the medical field once, you know, we're finished here, and we're able to make that change systemically instead of just, you know, coming and chanting and saying, we want, you know, everyone to make a change, and then that doesn't really do anything. Which it works in some places. Some places need that. Some places, you know, require that. But here, it's a much more open society. We're able to discuss these things. We have discussions all the time. Just me and my classmates sitting around, you know, walking around, we discuss things like this all the time. So it's not necessary for us to chant and, you know, try to create a change. There is a change. So we're just feeding right into that.
Yeah.